scientific meetings, or conferences, are pretty intense. The Society for Neuroscience meeting, or SFN, is enormous, with almost 30,000 attendees. It's like Comic-Con, but somehow even more nerdy. And just like Comic-Con, it's an opportunity for members of the community to showcase their newest work. I wasn't able to do any filming or photography inside the actual conference, because SFN has a no-media policy to protect the unpublished research of attendees. So, what do scientists do at their own con? We get to learn about a lot of new research. I wander through the poster hall, which is an enormous room filled with hundreds of poster boards where hundreds of scientists show off their most recent projects. There are also dozens and dozens of scientific talks, from nanosymposia, which are 10-minute talks, all the way up to the hour-long presidential keynote lectures, highlighting the most exciting neuroscience of the year. At this amazing gathering of the minds, I had the opportunity to meet a scientist who's doing some really interesting research to try and understand how our brains adapt to sensory information.
This is Carissa Whitmire from Georgia Tech in Atlanta, Georgia. She's a PhD candidate there, and she's here to tell us a little bit about her research. So thanks for joining us, Carissa.
Happy to be here, thanks. Yeah.
Can you tell me, what got you interested in neuroscience in the first place?
You know, I think I first got really excited about neuroscience when I realized that everything that we perceive is encoded by our brains. So I found that to be just such a fascinating topic that then I started doing this about 7 years ago and haven't quit.
What got you interested in like sensory adaptation in particular? How did you choose your thesis project?
I think I first got into sensation because every time we experience something like the brightness of a room or the smell of a flower, that's encoded in our brains. But what's really cool is that it's super dynamic. So this isn't something that something will smell the same way to you every single time. It can change as a function of what context it's presented in. So my thesis in all my work is really focused on this process of adaptation.
And you just published this really interesting perspective in the journal Neuron. Can you summarize your perspective for us?
Yeah, of course. So it's all about sensory adaptation, and it's about how information is encoded in a dynamic way. A lot of what we've done in sensory neuroscience is characterize what certain neurons might be sensitive to. Do they like a flash of light or a bar of light or a moving grating? And we think of that as a static property. But I think sensory adaptation has really taught us that the brain is very dynamic and that these properties can change on a moment-by-moment basis. So what we're really trying to show with this paper is that you can have this differential adaptation as a function of a ton of different variables that allows your brain to flexibly encode everything that you experience.
So if you were going to explain your recent perspective to a classroom full of fifth graders, how would you describe that research to them and why it's something that a fifth grader would find interesting?
When you go out on the playground and it's super bright out, you're essentially blind for a few seconds. You know, you go out there and your eyes almost hurt a little bit. But within a few seconds, you start to adapt and then you can see again and you can experience the playground and you can go out and have fun with your friends. Similarly, when you go to the movies, you go in and it's so dark, you can't see a thing. But then after a few seconds, you adapt. And so what this paper is really about is trying to link that process that we have that allows us to see on a playground or in a movie theater or in a classroom, and why a single neuron is capable of reaching each one of those states, yeah, handling each one of these things.
It's a really amazing like superpower that our brain has, right? To be able to just process everything and figure out how to compartmentalize it so that we can actually handle navigating the environment.
Absolutely. The fact that we can function daily is amazing.
Right, well, thank you so much for joining us today, Clarissa. It was really great to hear about your research and all the stuff that you're working on. So thanks so much.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
The whole week was an incredible opportunity to learn about new research, including Clarissa's. But SFN isn't only about the science. There are a lot of professional development and networking events, which are great opportunities for young scientists, like me, to learn from more experienced faculty and to make connections with future colleagues and mentors. And of course, when the conference hall closes for the day, those 30,000 scientists have to go somewhere. So like any good con, there are also parties. Beyond networking, these give a chance for attendees to relax, have fun, and catch up with friends and collaborators, many of whom they only have the chance to see at SFN. After this year's meeting, I'm feeling more excited than ever about my own research and the neuroscientific community as a whole. Thanks for watching this episode of Neurotransmissions. If you like conferences, hit the thumbs up button and subscribe to be the first to see our new videos. If you really like what we do, consider contributing to our Patreon. Having your support to keep making these videos is the icing on the cake, and we are so grateful to our patrons for making this possible. Until our next transmission, I'm Alie Astrocyte. Over and out.